And this time we'll go back to a bit of a model-independent approach, and it will look at electric constraints once you alleviate the assumption that everything has to be favored universal.
Okay, so the end of one of the talks in the previous section was the result of the fit of this fit in the flavor universal case of Adam Falkovsky and Riva. This is the flavorful electro. This talk is about the flavorful electroweak precision constraint on the dimension 6 operator. It's a work in progress with Eilert Efrat from Weizmann and Adam Falkovsky. And currently, the motivation, currently we don't see signs of new physics at the LHC. And the standard model gives a good description of the data. It's a good approximation on the weak scale. And we can capture heavy new physics effects by a higher dimensional operator in a roughly model independent way under the assumption of heavy new physics. And another fact that the precision measurement of, in this case, of the W and the Z pole observables can probe higher energy scales. There are other observables which we will not discuss today. And many were motivated for this Z, W, and pole observable because of the simplicity, and we don't want to deal with tons of four Fermi operators. We'll get to the details soon. We work under the following assumption, the usual Poincaré invariance. We have in our the new physics respect the full standard model gauge invariance of SU3 cross SU2 cross U1, which is broken by the Higgs doublet. New physics at heavy scale, and its main effects, its leading effects can be captured by the higher dimensional operator and the leading or the dimension 6 operator. But we don't assume any flavor universality. We released this assumption and want to see if we get some new information which can lead us. Yes?
What does this sentence mean?
I will explain in the next paragraph, but if you have, for example, the operator of the leptonic current L bar, the lepton doublets, gamma mu L, Higgs d mu Higgs, we'll see this. We assume that it can be different Wilson coefficient for the first generation, second generation, and anterior generation. They are not to be universal. Most of the works in this field, but unless we miss something, they assume that the flavor structure of the theory is universal. It's the same for all the flavors. And then in this way, you can avoid tension with other flavor observables, which are flavor violating. But we'll get into the details in a few moments, okay? So this our the effective Lagrangian is the standard model plus the bunch of the dimension 6 operator. For convenience, the scale that we put here is the Higgs wave, V square. And this is this C is our dimensionless, and this O will be our operators. If we'll see the bounds are C are order of 10 to the minus 3, it will tell us that we probe energy scale of roughly 10 TeV. What we can learn. So we consider only the pole observable, as we said, and which can give us the option to use a simple effective Lagrangian and the language of the correction to the W mass and to the Z and the W couplings. This is independent of any choose of the basis of the dimension 6 operator, just the couplings to the vertex themselves. Which is relevant to the observable that are being discussing. So any set of complete set of this dimension 6 operator can be mapped to this correction. This is the correction to the W mass. This is just QED and the QCD, so we don't correct them. And this correction to the W couplings, this the left-handed, the right current, and the leptonic left-handed. And these are for the Z. In principle, there is other observable like atomic parity violation or other things that we can consider. At this point of this work, we don't consider them in order to capture the leading effects that again and not involve all the bunch of huge amount of dimension of four fermion operators, besides the ones that we really need for these observables. So the framework and the field result. So the SU2 cross U1, the electroweak invariance of the new physics implies a few relations between these coefficients, between the correction to the W and the Z, which is this two correction. And all the dimension six operator can be parameterized into this to correction of the W mass, and this each one of these delta G's is in principle 3x3 matrix. It's don't have, and we don't assume any flavor structure on this. And flavor framework predict some relation between this correction of the coupling. For example, if we assume universality, that there's no any flavor dependence, which be each of this correction will be just the unit matrix. If we assume that our new physics is subject to the minimal flavor violation, it will be a different relation. Or some alignment that it's aligned the flavor in the flavor space with the standard model will be a different relation, or we assign Fogart-Nielsen charges for our fields. So the logic that behind is we fit for this delta G's, and we see that the fit result is different, and there is some flat direction in this fit. The upper bounds on each delta G's is different from the different generation. Then we can map this to the dimension six operator and consider a different flavor frameworks that will see the relation to other flavor observable, mainly of the non-diagonal. It's a question?
Yeah.
When you consider the top and the B, they have very different couplings to the Higgs, for instance, than the other light guys. So they could get completely different corrections. Is there one of this term for each of the quarks and leptons, or is it the same for all charged leptons?
Different for each one of them.
Different
in principle, it can be different. That's the releasing of the flavor universality assumption.
Okay, so you got.
So if for example, I measure only one asymmetry in the lep, I measure only the forward backward asymmetry for the BB bar, for B, then I will constrain only delta G left R where there is a index B,
right.
And I have no information about the first two generation. This is the extreme case. That's why it's important because, okay.
What I have not understood is the last
we are in the middle, yes, we will make it.
We'll make it.
I will partially make it. I will represent part of this result and part of the result, but it's still work in progress, as I said. Yes, this, see that it's true that in generic,
that's part of the problem, right?
Yes.
Yes.
Okay. Yes. Totally agree.
Sure.
In this. Let's talk about the pole observables. So the inputs for the fit is G Fermi or the Higgs wave, the mass of the Z, and the electroweak coupling at zero momenta. And the Z pole observable, there's a bunch of observable. We have the total width, the cross section for hadrons, and a different ratio of partial width. In the leptonics, it's measured for the separately for the electron, muon, and tau. In the quark sector, it's measured only for bottom and charm. And we have other ratio of in the up sector of up and charm, and for top, from LHC data, the ratio of the top couplings to Z. And we have the asymmetries, the left-right asymmetries, which is measured for the leptons and the bottom charm and strange separately. It's an independent measurement, and the forward-backward asymmetry, which is valid for the leptons and bottom and charm. And as you see, we have almost no information about the first two, independent information about the first two generation, about the second, the first generation here. And in the W pole observable, we have the branching ratio for the electronics, the mass and the width, of course, and the ratio of W to charm and strange over U and, should be U and D here, it's a typo, and on the third generation on the couplings to tops. We'll consider this observable. They are sensitive. Receives correction at linear order in delta G, which is the leading order. There are other observables you get. We'll consider in the future and the progress that are get that the leading contribution is delta G square, which are, will be also a forward like Z to E plus Z flavor violating observable, which also should be add, will add to this program. What this W and Z pole observable are not sensitive, which is important to stress. They don't probe CP violation. All these observable are CP, CP even. They don't probe off diagonal. They all are on the they all probe directly only the diagonal in the flavor space. Delta, the correction to the W to a quark doublets in the right hand current does not interfere with the standard model. It enters formally only on higher order in delta G in the dimension 6 operator. And since we have lack of information on the asymmetries on the first generation, there is one flat direction, which we have this tree relation, and this which depends on four couplings in principle, for the Z to up and down, and this tree equation that if one of this delta is equal to zero, it does not affect any of this observable, which gives us some flat direction. Totally, we can fit for 21 parameters in our analysis. So this is the result. We put all the information in the mechanism. So the most strongest constraint is on the correction to the W mass. It's our order of 10 to the minus 4. Next, the strongest at order of bounds are order of the promilies to the couplings of Z to leptons, the left and the right. And the next in the row at order of percent is the correction of the what? Okay. Is the W, which is weaker, and this also the upper bound on Z to Nini bar, it's at the same order of this guy from the because of the assumption of the electroweak invariance of the new physics. These are the bounds of the Z to quarks, and we see interestingly that what the releasing of the assumption of non-flavor universality, what is different is that the couplings in the up sector to the top is the constraints are much weaker, or only order of 10%, the upper bound. It can deviate by 10% from the standard model, the couplings to Z to top. So it's and to also to strange, because the measurement of the A sub S, the left-right asymmetry with strange.
Top, but you mean the U?
It's the top. It's U33. It's the top. Yes, it's it's the left-handed part of the top. And this is the right-handed, so it's are the same order. And this gives us also for the strange, it's a weaker constraint on this plot. So now we can map to flavor models. I will give two examples here. One for what's called alignment, where we align the new physics in the flavor space with the standard model. The second is a few words about the minimal flavor violation, which and in our checklist also a Fogart-Nielsen charts that we assign and a few more models. So these are the, if we look on the operator themselves, these are the relevant operators for these observables. So the structure, there are two observables that are flavor universal, which are the T and the WB. They don't contain any flavor information, so they are flavor universal. The one that corrects the lifetime of the muon, it's the only four Fermi operator that are relevant. It's a specific flavor assignment of muon and the electron. And the first one, two, three, four, five, six, seven operators have some left-handed or right-handed current, which is the L is the left-handed current of the leptons, D is the right-handed current, and same for the quarks, times the Higgs current. And they have some flavor structure. And that's what we released, that we don't assume that universality here. So we can see, put the bounds on the Cs, which are normalized to the which measure our deviation from the standard model in the units of the electroweak scale. And we will see that the bounds on DCs are between percent to per mil, which this probus effective scale of between 2 to 8 TeV depends on each operator in each flavor, as we see before. But we know that from flavor precision measurements that new physics at the TeV scale cannot have a flavor anarchic structure. It should be some alignment with the standard model. Otherwise, we'll get very soon, very fast to troubles. We'll have a large contribution to meson mixing or to for rare decays, which are well measured. So we need some alignment in the flavor space with the standard model. Let's start this. Assume the alignment, the higher dimension operator aligned with the standard model, so we can align the right-handed current separately for the up and down. So both can be just be a diagonal. So then in this way, we don't have any trouble with FCC. For the left-handed current, we can align or to the up sector or to the down sector. Or to the down sector, we cannot have both because of the CKM. But the flavor-changing neutral current will be suppressed by the CKM. The diagonal elements they don't obey any relation between them. So just three eigenvalues of this matrix, of this Wilson coefficients, and the operator that is cause some tension with flavor physics is the C Higgs at Q, which is this operator, and this operator, these two operators. And if we align to the up sector, then this QU, which is just a diagonal matrix, which is the coefficient, will be the coefficient of the in the up basis and in the down basis, which is relevant in flavor physics to down observable, like kernel mixing and big mixing, it'll be rotated by the CKM. And the down alignment is the vice versa. So if we align the operators that in the down basis are aligned, and we have the inverse rotation with the CKM for the up basis. And here the troubles are with char mixing and with top FCC. So the constraint that we get on the left-handed operators are roughly on the C Higgs Q or Higgs Q prime is roughly at one sigma at below 4%. So let's assume that we saturate this bound. So in up alignment, we get troubles. Get troubles with kernel mixing. With kernel mixing and with B mixing. While in down, if we do down alignment, which means that we don't have any problems with B mixing or kernel mixing, we tell us that we can have only coupling to the third generation. Char mixing, because otherwise we get, if there's couplings to the first two generation, we'll generate char mixing above the experimental bound, and we will be okay with the top FCCs. The last...
Wait a second. So then, what is the conclusion on the series?
This is, if I, the exercise, I saturate this bound, yes. And now I'm looking...
You have problems.
Yes, I have problems. If I up alignment, I have problems. Which means that the bounds from flavor precision are much stronger than electroweak. But if I have down alignment, I don't have this. If I have aligned to the down sector, I don't have problem. I can have still coupling to the third generation.
Yes.
Yeah. That's okay. It's not time. Not think it's. What do you mean?
Even in that case, flavor dominates as a constraint.
The dominant, yes, because the char mixing is the dominant constraint. Char mixing will tell us that you need to couple only to the third
right.
generation. Yes.
Right.
One last exercise. We can do the same exercise for the minimal flavor violation. I will not repeat it here. Just. Tell you the assumption on beyond minimal flavor violation that the approximate of vanishing Yukawa, the standard model obey a huge global symmetry, and all deviation above it should be proportional to the Yukawa. As this is the structure of the different Wilson coefficients of the quarks, the left-handed quarks, the right-handed quarks, and the leptons. And this here, the suppression will be much larger because it's not just a suppression of the CKM, it's also the suppression of the Yukawa itself, which besides the top are small. So just one disclaimer, it may that I miss, there's a lot of relevant works and that I put, I hope, most of the relevant references here. Maybe I skip or forget or didn't notice to some, so I apologize in advance. So this is what I found up to here about the relevant references. And this, just to summarize, we derive model independent bounds from the Z and W pole observable on the dimension 6 operator without assuming the flavor universality. There is one flat direction which is related to the first quark generation, which is there's no relevant measured asymmetry. The deviation of the Z couplings to top and strange quarks can be up to 10% of the standard model value, much weaker than the bounds of the other couplings. And I will add that the interplay with the different flavor observable is interesting, and we'll see that we need some alignment or other mechanism. That's all.
Okay, thank you. More questions?
I mean, if you take Z produced at LHC, and there is a paper by CMS, you have a measurement of the asymmetry and that is Z are mainly produced by first generation quarks. This can help in
depends
in
on
your flat direction.
It can help a lot. I should look on this. Thanks. it's good that the paper is not out yet. It will be really good. Okay.
Could you in principle also include G-2 of the muon into your analysis?
But I think it's G-2, it's the four fermion operators, which we
would
don't really
be,
want to deal
no,
with all the
would be a muon photon correction.
Yeah, it's muon, it's the chromomagnetic. We, in principle, we can do this. There's other chromo operators that affect because.
That's because we see a large deviation. It would be interesting to see whether this can fit or what effect it has.
In principle, it's not
a flavor mixing effect.
No, it's not. It's flavor diagonal.
Yeah, yep.
It's F mu nu mu bar mu, Higgs. If you to do it, yes, this can be interesting. Wonder it's not one of part of the set of this observable, of course, but it can be interesting. It's a different direction.
No more questions. Let's thank Yotam. Second time. And we come to the last talk of the day.